Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:04 p.m. Central Time on the 23rd of June, 2018. Here we are, Saturday night here in the States, Sunday internationally. I hope you're doing well. We're ready to talk about earthquakes. You guys ready to talk about some seismic events that have struck since last night? Let's turn on my display capture and get right into what has happened since my update 24 hours ago. And if you're not aware, we also do weekly earthquake forecasts every Sunday night, and we're on day 6 of the forecast now. Several of the areas have been hit this week, and I'll take you into the most recent activity right now. We're going to start down in New Zealand. Look what happened today. New multiple fours coming in at deep levels at above 200 kilometers deep. Or below 200 kilometers deep, depending on which way you want to look at this. And the force that's created down below the plate is going to be coming up on the underside of the plate in the next few days, specifically down to New Zealand. It'll be in my new forecast for this week. New Zealand was hit just as expected over the past several days, and the Kermadec Islands now moving with new deep quakes. Again, in the 200, I think 248, 250 is where we're at with both of these deep quakes. And these will be causing shallower, larger earthquakes up to 5.0. Not just anywhere, but to the south, just like our previous sets of quakes. And it's going to be hitting the North Island, but we also have some activity going on across North and South New Zealand, spreading across the plate boundary. You see the red line here? This red line goes across, and it's a break in the plate that goes from the surface all the way down into the magma down below the plate in an area called the asthenosphere. And when there's force created to the north, it pushes up on the underside of the plate here, and it causes new activity to bottleneck right where the bend comes across the plate. And right there, Kaikoura, north to Wellington, we have a new swarm breaking out, as well as a multiple swarms breaking out across the North Island following yesterday's 5.0 activity. And we're going to look between Christchurch and Kaikoura up to the Cook Strait for new activity to hit in the next few days. But I'll have that in my forecast tomorrow night. Getting over to the west in the last 24 hours, here's yesterday's 5.5. Really coming in this morning, but 5.5 striking in Vanuatu, right next to New Caledonia. I want to be specific. When I say New Caledonia, that's the island here, and Vanuatu is right here, and we have two volcanoes that are erupting, Aoba, and also right next to it, Langila, over to the west in Papua New Guinea. So we have two nearby eruptions going on. Oh, Yasser as well. Let's not forget Yasser erupting here just a few days ago. Over to the west, we have a new deep earthquake. Again, that technically struck yesterday, so we can get that out of here. We're looking for a shallower, larger movement to pop up from this deep earthquake from yesterday. We have not seen it yet. We have to look for up to 7 days from the point of the deep quake. Yesterday was day one. Today technically carries over into day one, which means we have 6 more days to go watching around this deep quake. Now, why is that again? There's a force placed on the underside of the plate, and it comes up and finds the crack in the plate, which is the plate boundaries. New earthquake struck over here, 5.0, 4.9, and a 4.3. Mayette Island. This is a volcano that has not erupted in 5,000 years. And I do have some good news for the people in Mayette. New activity has now struck down in southern Africa, South Africa to be specific. And that's good to some extent. Force is flowing around Mayette Island at this point. We want to see earthquake activity begin to strike again in southern Africa. Right now, new 5.0 earthquake, that can be traced right back to where our deep earthquake is. And Mount Krakatoa also erupted just the other day. That's right, Krakatoa, the blast heard around the world. Well, this one wasn't heard around the world unless you watched my YouTube video, of course. It was a smaller blast. As we go up to the north, another deep quake, 365 kilometers deep. And let's go consult our depth to magnitude conversion chart put together by Bella and Rebecca. And if we look at 365, you'll be able to see clearly we go up 0.7 magnitude. Again, depth to magnitude conversion. Add on 0.7 magnitude to this, and this takes us to 4.9. A new 5.0 earthquake is likely to be striking very soon next to it in Japan. And that will be in my forecast as well tomorrow night. As we go over to the west, another deep earthquake. We're dealing with a deep earthquake event that is ongoing. There is force being placed down below the whole plate, and it's spreading out into the other plates. And when you see a new set of deep earthquakes spread across 5,000 miles, it's a sign of building force below the whole region. And we're looking for a larger earthquake to release in the middle of all this, right next to the 5. Just to be specific, in case you didn't know, this deep quake is going to be causing up to a 6.6 right next to it. Okay? As we go over to the west from there, again today in Iran, for my Iranian viewers and my people in Iraq, we've got a few people watching in Iraq, I know that. We've got people like left over from the military there, I think, that are still stationed there. They wrote me and they watch. I don't know how they get my videos. Maybe they have YouTube access. Well, nonetheless, we have a 4.5 and 4.6. Let's get all these other smaller quakes out of here. 4.5 and 4.6 in Iran, and a new 4.6 in eastern Turkey. These three are all tied together, all three of these quakes. All we have to do is go back a couple days, and I told you there's been some 5.0 activity up here in North China that's just not making it to our feeds. So you have to imagine a few fives back behind this, and then force travels out across, and in Iran, salam to you guys, much love, but for real, in Iran, down on the plate boundary, that's the spot to get hit when force is applied out of Egypt. It's coming into eastern Turkey, and we take a step down from there, and where do we go? We go across Turkey, and we dead end into the Aegean Sea and Greece. Aegean Sea and Greece, multiple threes, a 3.3, and lo and behold, a 3.3 up in North Italy, and a 3.3 over here at the Azores. Is that the Canaries? That's the Canaries. As we go to the north, a 3.3 up in Iceland. Do you see a connection here? Again, we have 3.3s spreading out across all of Europe in the course of a day. And we take it down, you'll be able to see the most recent earthquake. It's a more rare earthquake up here in Sweden with a 3.1. Well, if we have 3.3s all across Europe, and then we have a 3.1 out south of Iceland, these are all tied together as well. And this one is rare. We don't normally see much activity striking in Sweden at all. Let's get the information on this. 10 kilometer depth, 3.1 magnitude. Pretty interesting. You know what? Maybe we should put the information in and just go take a look at it over on Google Earth. I did not look this up earlier today, so I'm going to learn something. Maybe you will too. And sometimes you might even find that there's a reason for the earthquake striking at this epicenter, but you know there might not be. Oh, we have a giant body of water. Let's see what else we have going on here. Well, right in the middle of a giant body of water. Interesting. I have all my place marks turned on for the Smithsonian. There's no volcanic features all across all of Scandinavia. Okay. That can't be right. Well, I guess they just haven't done any research up here for volcanism, maybe. Or maybe they just don't have place marks on Google Earth. Well, nonetheless, there's nothing there to show to you. It's a giant body of water. It could be the weight of the water. Could be post-glacial rebound effect. It's PGRE. And that's when crust rebounds upwards and causes slight activity in the 3 and 4.0 range, usually as the crust breaks as the expanding tundra-like surrounding bedrock softens and basically goes from a hardened state to a softened state, and there's earthquakes that accompany that. That's post-glacial rebound effect. But it usually happens over many, many miles, not just at a single epicenter. So you get deformation over a vast area, and there might be earthquakes that accompany that when it occurs. Altogether, threes striking across Europe. By tomorrow, if this doesn't go up to four, That's good. I've been looking for this to go up to possibly into the mid-range 4 level. So far, we've gone to mid-range 3. And that's good. We want to see it come in less than expected. It means some of the force is being absorbed across the way. And as long as it transfers across, as long as we see it transferring all the way out to its termination point, that's a good thing. If it gets blocked somewhere along the way and we don't see it spread out, that's a bad thing. That usually means building up into some kind of larger earthquake activity. Before we get into Hawaii, let's quickly jump into South America. Today, look what I've got to show to you. Here's two earthquakes from last night, the 2.5s. But we can get those out of there. Those technically struck last night going into this morning. But again, on the 22nd is when those are reported. And then we just take a look at what happened today. Only 4s striking across Central America at El Salvador and Nicaragua. Well, Nicaragua just had the eruption at Telica volcano that the news completely ignored. And I want to show it to you again. It was a big blast, and somehow this thing got missed by everybody. Telica volcano eruption. Okay, here we are. All right, I mean, there we go. I mean, look who's carrying the news. We've got YouTube channels carrying the news. Oh, wait, there we go. Express got it. And the Chinese news agency also has it. Okay, well, the Chinese news agency is beating the Western media to a volcano in our own backyard. For some reason, they don't want people to know about a big blast down here at Nicaragua. Maybe it's because of the big blast that just happened here at Fuego. Might start to ask some questions. And we don't want to have any troublesome questions asked, so it better just leave the volcano off the feeds and leave everybody in ignorance. So, you know, the bear crap's in the woods and nobody's there to hear it. Does it make a sound? Or wait, that's if a tree falls in the woods. I don't want to use the tree analogy because I don't want to offend Bob the Bush. Don't ask. As we go out here to the Central Pacific, take a look at what's going on here at Hawaii. We've got ourselves a new earthquake, a 4.0, striking west-northwest of the Big Island. Now, this is somewhat rare. We don't normally see 4.0 activity, 3.9. We'll call it a 4. We can go over to the origin page really quick, take a look at what the magnitudes are for this. Well, we know it's not a 2.3. Here, let's go down the list. I always throw out the high and I always throw out the low, and that gives us a good broad swath in between of what the stations are detecting, and that maybe will help us determine what an actual magnitude is, aside from their downgrade or upgrade. So we have 4.3, 4.2, 3.9, 4.2, 3.9, 3.9, 4.1, 2.6. We'll throw those out, and we throw out the high-end 4s too. So we'll throw out these 4.3s. And then that leaves us with something like a 4.0 earthquake, somewhere in that range. So we're probably at a 3.9 to 4.0. It's pretty accurate where they're coming in on this earthquake, at least by what I would consider a good broad swath of averages. Well, let's go put the coordinates in and see what's there. And before we get into this, I want to tell everybody, Hawaii has been a topic of major discussion by many people online. And there's been some really irresponsible reporting on it done by the media and by people online, you know, YouTube video makers, trying to scare people into, well, everything from moving away from Hawaii to trying to give to fundraisers. And when I'm looking at this, I don't want you to be alarmed. A 4.0 earthquake striking out here is pretty small. It's nothing big, but it is a new location in light of what's going on down here at Kilauea. With what's going on at Kilauea and the collapse going on at Kilauea, if we start seeing other earthquakes strike at other volcanoes nearby, it's a sign that there's a shifting happening in Hawaii as a whole, the whole Big Island, slightly moving. That's not a sign that Hawaii is going to be falling. It doesn't have anywhere to fall. Take a look. It's mounded up on all sides. In order for Hawaii to fall, it has to be able to fall into something, and there's no big open rift or any kind of hole or anything for Hawaii to slide into. So if there were portions that were to subside, it wouldn't be much because this thing is huge. 65 miles across at the top, or 100 kilometers across. And over here, where the earthquake is striking, never heard of this before, and I've never read it. So let's go ahead and read it. Try to pronounce this thing. Mahukona. Mahukona. The Pleistocene Mahukona seamount lies between the islands of Hawaii and Kahoolawa, northwest of Hualalai Volcano. The distinct cone is about 4 kilometers in diameter. That's just one cone. This is 4 kilometers in diameter. But you'll be able to see we have others nearby, at least 4 or 5, that are also about the same size. So we've got a big volcanic field, and then there's several thousand or maybe several hundred smaller cones that make up this volcanic field. Now this is at the sea floor. We have pretty much the same thing going on up here at Hualalai, only it's on land, so you can see it much better. So we have about the same number of cones that you would have there that you have out here. Pretty interesting, right? Okay, so we have a 4.0 there. Now we go down to the south and take a look at what else has gone on in the last day and a half. Look at our line of earthquakes. Maybe I should turn the rings off. Let's do that. Let's turn the rings off. You see how we have a 3.4 between Mauna Loa and Mauna Kea? We also have a 3.1 on the northern flanks of Mauna Kea, or Mauna Loa. And then we go down to the south and we have a cluster of earthquakes south of Mauna Loa. And then over to the east, our big stack of earthquakes still carrying on at Kilauea. It's a lot going on, seismically speaking. Guys, this is not an exaggeration on my part. We have a line of quakes in the last day and a half, starting at Kilauea, going up across in between the two large volcanoes on the island, connecting up to a Pleistocene volcano now off to the west-northwest. It's significant. There's a shifting that's happening. If somebody was proficient in measuring GPS, I would recommend that you start measuring Hawaii immediately and compare it to where it was a month ago and a year ago, especially down to the east-southeast. You might very well find that there's been surface deformation going across the entire area where the earthquakes have spread out to. That would mean all the way up to this 3.9. What's the name of this thing again? Mahukona. From Mahukona all the way down to Lo'ihi. So what does that signify? Where does that put us? It puts us on both sides of the big island, at the undersea edge of the big island. You can see where they both meet up. The big island here meets up with the next island over to the west. Again, Kahoolawa. I'm butchering that, but you see it. Now, why would it shift? Why would there be a shift? Well, a magma chamber the size of Kilauea's has fully drained. There's collapsing that's going on, and we need to go over to the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory, where they have now placed a temporary GPS station as of 2 to 3 days ago. Temporary GPS has been set up here, so they can measure what's going on inside the crater. We'll bring this up, though, and they haven't released any new flyovers of the crater. On the 21st, it said that they were going to be doing some kind of drone flyover. And as far as I know, they have not released the drone flyover yet. But again, that was the 21st. This video is just lava flowing through a river. Here, I'll show this to you here. Time lapse, and these are boats of lava on the surface floating through. And that's what they call them again. Again, lava boats. But they don't have anything on the crater. So we're going to have to go down and take a look at the last radar image that we have right here, which will show it's an animated GIF image. You'll be able to see the expanding crater going into the expanding caldera. First, the crater collapsed. Then it started to grow. And now we're growing into a new caldera, or maybe a combination of the two, that the caldera is slightly shifting. And the crater has grown beyond the crater, greatly beyond the crater. It taken in the road and the parking lot. And this imagery is as of 4 or 5 days ago. Every day now, there's been new collapses happening. And we can consult their live stream here. And where the steam is coming off here, on the left-hand side of the screen, where the steam is coming off, most likely there's going to be another cleaving off of the side. Again, across as well, on the other side of the crater, you can see those spots. Those are going to continue to break off. and fall in. Why? There's no magma underneath right now. At least as far as I know, maybe there might be some resurgence of magma coming back into the chamber, but it's not enough to support the weight up on top. And that's why we're getting all these collapses going down inside of Kilauea. And man, oh man, as this is the old shot of it, this thing is gone. The entire floor of the crater fell in, lava drained out, the lava tube emptied out, and that's what supported the weight of all this down below was all that magma. And it's shifted over to the east, come out through the fissures, gone out to sea, or still happening. It's still ongoing in Hawaii right here. As that continues to drain, as long as it continues to drain over here, I would think that this thing's not going to refill. Once it does start to refill, I've got some questions. Down inside of here, this is all collapsed in. The tube that used to supply the lava lake is now fully covered with rubble going down thousands of feet, millions of tons of rubble on top of where the lava lake used to reside. When magma starts to come back into the chamber and come back up the old lava tube that fed the lava lake, where's it going to come out? What's going to happen? These are questions I can't answer, but I want you to think about. As magma is coming back up in the chamber and going back up this tube and filling gradually over the course of days or weeks, it's going to hit a point where it's corked off on the top. And only a few things that I can think of could happen. One, pressure builds and it blows, revealing a new lava lake of some kind. But it would first blow and it would be a pretty big blast, obviously. Second thing that could happen would be that it would come up, hit the corked point, and then branch off, and we'd see a new series of earthquakes as this magma pushes its way through a tube and it blasts out a new hole somewhere, entirely different. Third option, it's not likely, but it could happen, not likely though, that it dies, that the magma comes back up, hits the cork at the top, and it tufts off. Then pressure would build over a long period of time, not weeks or months, but maybe even years, and you would start to see a bulge and a maybe even a new huge blast as a new caldera forms of some kind. Again, this would be something that doesn't happen in Hawaii, but every few thousand years, maybe, if that happened. So I don't think that's likely. I think one of the other two scenarios is much more likely. It's not just going to come back up and gradually ooze out into a lava lake, and it's not going to come up and melt the rock millions of tons on top of it. No way. So that means it's going to build into something, whether it's a blast or whether it travels and then blasts. How far will it travel? I don't know. Again, these are things that nobody would know until it starts to resurge. Right now, there's nothing in it to surge. It's still collapsing. So we'll know when it's ready to resurge. It'll stop collapsing. Every time it collapses, new 5.0 earthquake spreading out from the location. How about that? Now, let's jump over to the United States. Let's get into what's going on here. We've got some activity that's developed on the west coast of the United States. Let's turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed. We're going to start, this time, up here in the Pacific Northwest. We've got some stuff to get into. Take a look at this. First of all, up in the Northwest, we've got a single 1.6 earthquake off the coast of Washington going up into Vancouver Island. And we have a cluster of earthquakes down here. I'll show you what's at this location in just a moment, but we need to go consult the real-time tremor map from the University of Washington. This will really help us. We need to see what's happening with the plate slipping. The plate has slipped over the past several days up here to the northwest, and over the past 2 days, it's picked up in earnest. See all these red dots that just appeared when I clicked 24 hours? We're looking at the last day's worth of tremors on the west coast. Tremors are not exactly earthquakes. They are small vibrations as the plate is shifting. Now, these lead to large earthquakes. As the plate shifts, it will then build up in stress, and according to professionals, it will then release that stress and almost like a spring loading on a nearby fault to where the slow slip is happening. And there's a huge fault to where this is happening right next to it. I'll show it to you on Google Earth here. It's known as one of the most famous faults on the planet, the Juan de Fuca. Right next to here, to the south, is the Strait of Juan de Fuca, coming out to the Cascadia subduction zone, and then further out to the actual Juan de Fuca fracture zone. But it's all connected right here, and this is moving 48 hours. Look, we have two distinct clusters, yesterday and today, then it just went down to the south. So we have one distinct cluster to the south, and then further to the south, a cluster down in Northern California. In between here, in Oregon, we have one single small tremor. That's it. And when we look at earthquakes, now let's go look up these little swarms of quakes. We're going to go 23 kilometers north of Packwood, Washington. And longtime viewers, that should ring a bell. Anytime you hear me say Packwood, you know where we're going to look. As I zoom in, I want you to pay attention to where the earthquake swarm is happening. It's happening on the flanks of Mount Rainier. Mount Rainier, stratovolcano that it can be seen from Seattle, but we had a swarm down below the crater over the past couple days. Now we're on the side of the volcano. And I've told you that this is a normal occurrence. First we see the crater get hit, then the outside flanks of the volcano start to rise. First the center rises, then the outside edges rise, like a circus tent top being pushed up. And that's what's happening at Mount Rainier. As we go down to the south, just a single microquake, basically next to nothing. But we're 37 kilometers north-northeast of Amboy, Washington. A tremor where? Let me show you. We're going from Mount Rainier to the exact very center of the crater of Mount St. Helens on its rising dome. So Mount St. Helens and Mount Rainier both showing a rise today, slight activity around the volcanoes. As we go over to the east, take a look at this small earthquake striking next to the fracking operations south of Yellowstone. And I'll pull the coordinates here. You guys are welcome to go look South Park, Wyoming. Hey, if you change that by a state, we might actually get on TV or something here when I show you what's there. Now, you might think some blockheadedness like South Park might be going on here when you see what they're doing nearby. Look what it is, guys. Now, here it is. Here's Jackson Hole. So everybody's familiar with Jackson Hole. Here's Lake Yellowstone, and the park comes down to here. These are the Tetons. But the greater magma chamber for Yellowstone is 11 Grand Canyons in size. It goes all the way up across Montana, across Idaho, and comes back into Wyoming here. But again, it's huge. So we get down to the south and our earthquake striking right here. Now you might not be able to make it out at this elevation. I know what to look for. Longtime viewers know what to look for. But for new people, it might look like sand dunes to you at first. But as I zoom in, you'll probably start to make out these small little indentations into the landscape. And this is just one example. What we've got going on here, major gas and oil extraction. In other words, drilling. They're doing fracking, they're doing wastewater disposal, they're also doing oil pumping. And that's just right there. We go across, and again, it takes a trained eye to really be able to see these. But once you start to zoom in, you'll be able to make them out. And they're all over the place up here. And you'll be able to make out, here's the shadows of the jacks and the pumps exposed out here with a pipeline connected to all the others. And it just goes on and on for miles and miles. And that just, it carries on. I mean, we're over here on the right-hand side or eastern side. We're over here again. They look like sand dunes from this high. And we get right to where our earthquake is. Now, are they up here? Our imagery date as of 2014, I don't have a good answer for you. Are they doing new drilling up here? They very well could be. They might already have. Could even be at these locations here. There might be new drilling going on. I do not have an answer due to the age of the photography, aerial photography in this case. As we go over to the west though, so now let me recap. We have activity and a slow slip up to the northwest, and Vancouver Island is the plate is shifting. Next to the plate shifting, Mount Rainier and Mount St. Helens are shifting. Next to Mount St. Helens and Mount Rainier, we have a slight shift at the pumping operations, just ever so slight. So force is remaining out here for the most part. It's bordered in by the volcanoes to the north. as we go down to the south. This gets really hairy. We can start here in Northern California, or we can start in Northern Nevada. Either or, what I'm getting ready to show you, all the way across here, all of these locations are volcanic related and geothermal. Well, except for this. This right here is a pumping operation, oil and gas. So we have drill points and we have Mother Nature punch points. This location over to the west where the stack of earthquakes is. Here, let me wait for the earthquakes to refresh. This here is Geysers, California. Now the name speaks for itself. Here, oh wait, hold on. Depending on which earthquake you click on, by the way, from the USGS, you're going to either get Geysers or Cobb, California. They're both taking you to the same location. They're triangulated from a slightly different coordinate. And when I show you what's there, I've already showed it 10,000 times in the past year. We'll make it 10,001. Take a look at the screen. Learn again, if you haven't already learned, about geothermal pumping operations and the drill points that they have and how they are vulnerable when forces coming across the plate. It's not just fracking, it's not just oil, it's drill points that go down hundreds to thousands of feet. They are the weak points in the crust. If you drill, you go down a few hundred to a few thousand feet or more, you are vulnerable to seismic pressure as it comes across the plate. In this case, we're going down hundreds of feet into the flanks of Clear Lake Volcano, which is the greater volcano marked from the Smithsonian. That's where we're starting. Now we go up across the pumping operation that I just told you about. It's not an exaggeration. We're going right into the middle of an oil pumping op in northern Sacramento Valley, north of a volcano. So there's a volcano just to the south of here in Sacramento Valley. Take a look. And let me back this out ever so slightly. Here are our Sutter Buttes. These are a set of volcanoes. You're welcome to pause it and read it. Starting at the Sutter Buttes, we've got ourselves a wastewater disposal and fracking operation connected by pipelines, indicating that they're not just putting something in, but they're also taking something out. It goes up here and it makes a curl around the volcano. It's not geothermal. And we go up here across the river, and we pick back up at another pumping operation, just like the one around the volcano, whoops, right here. And all these little pads you see spread out. It's not, they're not doing water pumping here, guys. They got a river right next to it. These are all for oil and gas. As we go further, we go up to the east-northeast. We're going to go north of Lake Tahoe, and we'll pull this earthquake here. Let's see if we can get it. 0.5. Incline Village, Nevada. Nevada. Hey, got a viewer up here, Casimirio, probably in chat. Hopefully he's in chat. Went and climbed up on the mountaintop right here. Let me show you where he did some climbing. Right here. Oh, wait. Hold on. Let's get it. Here. Right on Sunflower. Now, the reason one of my viewers climbed up here, there's been an ongoing swarm going on down below this location. It started over at Steamboat Springs. Steamboat Springs, another volcano, go figure. And at the volcano is a huge geothermal pumping operation, go figure, where they've drilled in hundreds to thousands of feet and are extracting huge amounts of steam to turn these massive geothermal turbines. These are way bigger than the ones that we see just down in Cobb or Geysers, California. Right next to it, that's where our swarm transferred to. It's my contention that down below this location is the greater magma chamber for Steamboat Springs, which is right next to it. So Steamboat is here, and the magma chamber probably goes all the way down, and it meets underneath the peak of Sunflower, and that's where we're having our new earthquake swarm. We go up to the east-northeast. We go into Pyramid Lake, which is a place also called the Needles at Pyramid Lake. It's a fumarole field or geyser field, but mainly fumaroles, and I'll show it to you here. You can't go there. I told people, I'm like, oh, it would be awesome to get out there and get out in a boat and go. It's an Indian reservation and nobody's allowed to go here. Apparently some stupid tourist did some stupid tourist stuff here. Pillow lava formations, old fumaroles, huge on the side of Pyramid Lake. And we go up to the east-northeast from there to our 1.1, striking out here in the middle of the desert, Gerlach Empire, Nevada. We'll show you what's there. And we already looked these up yesterday, but we're looking them up again. Calico Mountains Volcanic Center. Fly Geyser Volcanic Butte here. Fly Geyser. But that's a place where they drilled, by the way. This is a spot where somebody drilled in the past for something. I don't know what they were drilling for, but it ruptured and it formed a geyser. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Fly Geyser. Look it up if you're interested. So we're right here and we're at Calico Mountains, a set of ancient volcanoes. And those are just south of more younger formations like Black Rock Point, which Black Rock Point kind of looks like Cerro Prieto down in Southern California. So I think I'm proving my case so far. All these locations are right next to volcanoes. We could keep going over to the east, 6.8 kilometer depth at Lovelock, Nevada. I love looking these up because it proves that there's perturbance happening at these ancient volcanoes. But why? Why are these ancient? Look at this. This is not even marked. It's an unmarked volcanic field. Mopung Hills, unmarked. Not even a place marked. But no doubt about it, ancient volcanism at the location. These don't just look like volcanoes. The black basalt and igneous rock on the sides of these hills with no vegetation. And that's a true color image. Going up to the north, Lone Mountain Butte Volcano is the only one that's marked. I'll be dang. Look at that. Lone Mountain out there. It's like Mount Doom. Black Mountain Volcano is to the north just a little bit. Let's show you that one, since that one is marked. Well, I mean, it looks almost the exact same as the other down to the south. The other one does not have a place mark. I'm shocked. Lava Bed State Park across the whole area. Maybe that's what it's part of. Down to the south, what do we have here? Soda Lakes again? I always look within 40 miles. Let's see how far that is. I always look within 40 miles because these magma chambers can shift that far over a long period of time, over millions of years, that the plate can move and the magma chamber can move. 28 miles to the south are the actual Soda Lakes marked by the Smithsonian. Okay, I mean, we are in between the two. There's no doubt about that. Going over all the way over into central Nevada, central eastern Nevada, we're going to go to Carlin. And I believe there's something there. I remember Carlin from a few years ago when a swarm broke out here. Now it's getting hit again. Coming across the area. What's at Carlin? All right. Oh, yeah. Big Butte. Big Butte. It's not Big Butte. It's Big Butte. But Big Butte doesn't really look like a volcano now, does it? Take a look at it. I guess on one side, we might still be able to make out the old lava flows. Yeah, okay. Well, that's ancient. This may have even formed back when there was still water out here in the basins. That would make a little sense if it formed under some kind of shallow sea or shallow lake bed that used to extend. Salt Lake City used to extend. You can see where the Great Salt Lake used to go out to here, but it used to connect all the way through here, guys. Everywhere where there's a salt basin used to be filled with ancient water. Now, scientists incorrectly state that this was full from water that was from the Ice Age. Okay. Well, we won't go there with the glacier, with the debunking the glacier theories. As we go down to the south, we get into the California-Nevada border on both sides. Yet, once again, we're going to go on the Nevada side of the border first. So I just proved to you, all those locations directly next to volcanoes within our realm of acceptability, which we've always searched within 40 miles. And where are we going now? We're going right down on two sets of volcanoes, Aurora Peak and Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. Aurora Crater here and Aurora Bodie. Feel free to pause it and read it if you need to. We're on the back side of it now. Mount Hicks. Don't normally have to show Mount Hicks. Normally we're on the front side or the northern side of these volcanoes down here in the basin. So on this time, we're on the back side of this cluster of volcanoes. We're much closer to Mono Lake Volcanic Field, which is the greater player for the region. As we go across Mono Lake, we get over here on the southern side at a place called Mammoth Mountain, right here. And Mammoth Mountain is the ski resort. Next to it is where the earthquake swarm is happening, at a place called Whitmore Hot Springs, just due south of there. As we go down to the California-Nevada border further to the south, we're going next to the Yubihibi craters, just to the north of them. So it should be just to the north. Let's put them in. I mean, how about this, guys? Every set of quakes next to a set of volcanoes? I mean, do we really need to spell this out for you? Here are the Yubihibi craters. And let me show them to you. From above, they look like mountaintops. As we zoom in, we're going to go down inside the crater because this is a blast caldera here. This didn't just collapse in. This blasted out in the past. And we have several other cones, cinders, spatter cones, well, really separate volcanoes that are huge in their own right next to it. And this is the youngest formation. We go up all the way up into here where the old, I would call this the old Yubihibi craters here, and the even older or more ancient to the west. So the younger is in the middle, and our earthquake is striking on the flanks of the greater feature that goes all the way up to here. Now, it could very well be that this whole thing here is part of the ancient volcanic complex, but this is the spot that we would focus on now as being the cause. So how many miles? Let's just get a quick measurement. See? Didn't do this earlier today. Wanted to do it live. 20 miles. Okay. Again, it's such a large formation that the magma chamber has to at least extend out 10 miles in all directions, or one direction to the north, south, east, or west. We're getting an earthquake striking on the flanks of that. As we go down into Southern California, are you starting to get the drift? What I'm showing you here? Let's go pull this earthquake down to the south. Place 21 kilometers east of Little Lake. Well, it's out in the middle of Death Valley, what I'm getting ready to show you, but you'll understand why an earthquake striking there in about 2 seconds. Here we are. We are right next. See this? This is all lava flow here. Volcano Peak, made up of about 6 to 7 other cinder cones. And then over to the east, we have several others. Volcano Butte, unnamed volcanic butte, but Volcano Butte here is really a huge, massive thing here. I mean, it's, how many are here? 1, 2, let's see, this is a spatter cone. There's an actual volcano feeding a large lava flow. You can see where the lava flows come off these older volcanoes and go down, but they're covered over a long period of time. Man, I just love looking at these things. That's just so interesting. As we get over down to the south by southeast, where are we going? Actually, you know what? First, let's go check here along the coast. You see this line of quakes? This is going right along the creeping section of the San Andreas, and the largest earthquake of the bunch on the creeping section, right in the middle. In the middle of what? In the middle of all the earthquakes that struck today. Our largest earthquake struck on the creeping section. That's no shock. It's a 3.1. And this happens regularly, where the middle point between all the points that are moving on the creeping section gets the largest earthquake. Now, let's go off the coast of Santa Barbara. There's a reason the earthquake's striking here, and it's not a volcano. There's something right offshore that's causing the earthquake. Might give away what you think's there. You could probably think in your mind quicker than I can show you. Here, look. We're at an offshore drilling platform yet once again. And this is a regular occurrence when forces coming down the plate, our drill points get hit. Whether they're offshore drilling platforms, whether they're onshore and in the valley, does not matter. If it's down a few hundred to a few thousand feet, it's a vulnerable point, just as I've told you with all the other locations up to the north. As we get now into Southern California, the Anza Gap slow slip location is really moving, and it started to pick up. It's focused off. It's again focused in on Southern California. Now, what's going on there? There's been a series of papers and studies that have been released by professionals over the last year, particularly back in October, but since then, even in the past few weeks, there's been a few papers released talking about Southern California and the slow slip going on here that's going to be leading to a large earthquake on a nearby fault to where the slow slip is occurring. The slow slip is happening on the San Jacinto, J-A-C-I-N-T-O, and it's going to be transferring most likely to the plate boundary when this large earthquake does strike. The plate boundary, of course, is the San Andreas, which goes from here all the way up the coast, meeting up with San Francisco at the Hayward Fault, and then continuing up the coast, out off the shores, and meeting up with our plate boundary at the Juan de Fuca. So really, we've got a slow slip going on up here in Vancouver, going into Washington almost, and we have a slow slip going on in Southern California. Connecting in between, well, I just showed you all these volcanoes going across California and Nevada's border and drill points. So we're missing earthquakes here in Oregon. That's just extremely interesting, since the earthquakes are yet once again stopping right at the border. And scientifically speaking, Mother Nature cannot know where the borders of Oregon are. So we're only left with one logical answer to why earthquakes keep stopping at the Oregon border. And I do not believe in David Copperfield type magic. I'm really thinking that it's a lack of reporting that's going on out of the state. And that may be due to some special orders issued, may be due to some politics, may be due to some big money, who knows, but whatever the reason, it's not good that the earthquakes are not being reported. Now, the same time that that's going on, there is something that popped up on College of DuPage that I want to show you. Just, you know, again, it's a forest fire of some kind, I think, but it's hard to tell. So I'll go show you what I'm talking about here. Let's zoom in on Oregon. There we go. All right, let's get North Oregon open. And I'm going to hit play on the last 96 images. Actually, let's get the last 200 images. And we're going to start at the start of the day. It's sunrise. It's beautiful out. There's nothing going on. And watch what happens here. We get ripple cloud. And then all at once, look at this. All at once, look. Both volcanoes, let me show you what's there. Hold on. All at once, miles around, going all at once. That's not a control burn, I'll tell you that right now. They're not gonna, that's huge, this location. Let me show you what's there. Now, again, I don't want anybody to get, you know, too wound up over what's happening here or anything. We'll come in here. Hold on, let's match our areas perfectly. I can turn on, by the way, we can turn on different functions. And some of the functions that we can turn on are counties. So I want to turn on our counties so that we can get a good shot of which county this is in and where it's happening. All right, so we see these two. Here's our counties. Should be pretty easy to triangulate. Happening here. All across here, all at once. Here. Interesting. And happening across here, all at once. Right next to Mount Hood. Is that correct? I think that's correct. Let's make sure about that. Yeah. It's one county to the east of Mount Hood. So, you know, it could be fires. I mean, you know, if it's going to be some kind of surging magma coming up next to one of the volcanoes, fires would break out first. I mean, yeah, that's a pretty much a given. Now, would they tell us? No. No. No, they wouldn't. They wouldn't tell us at all. No media would tell you. No one will tell you. Only you'll see it maybe here. Maybe where we'll tell you that this might be something volcanic related. That it could be. It very well could be. Now, I can't prove it other than it's happening all at once in a circular formation next to a volcano that just got hit by an earthquake yesterday. Now today, radio silence back out of Oregon as that goes on. I don't know. With what's going on down to the south, you might want to put two and two together on that and just watch, just in case. Man, could you imagine if something like that happened on the west coast? Now let's get over here to our final earthquake of the day that we're going to talk about, which is a 2.4 striking where? In Georgia. Now, I've got some questions about this earthquake. Let's go look it up and see what's there. 1.6 kilometer depth, that usually rules out man-made operations, or I mean mines and those sorts of things. Now, they can drill down. I've gotten in debates with professionals who told me they drilled down 5 miles. So really, we got to go look and see what's at the location, see if there's anything nearby that stands out. Now, already I'm seeing something here that might be a sign of maybe, just maybe, that they were doing some kind of strip mining, maybe some kind of exploration. They've got clearly planted new plants, and we've got some kind of old roads meeting up here. Pretty interesting mining going on next to this, and we've got our volcano to the west-northwest. Yes, there was a volcano in west-northwest Georgia. Pigeon Mountain, go ahead and look that up right here. And Pigeon Mountain's pretty far away. It's over 40 miles, that's for sure. But look at the bend in the edge of the craton. Let me turn off my borders and labels, and we'll go ahead and turn off everything so you can just see the edge of the plate. Here we go. All right. So now what you're going to see, you're going to see a U-shaped bend that goes down through Georgia and comes back up into Missouri here. And this is the New Madrid seismic zone. This U-shaped bend that goes down to the south, we are right on it. Do you see how it goes back across? Do you see this? This is the southern edge of the North American craton. And I'll show you a craton graphic just to prove it to you. This graphic can be found almost anywhere by searching Laurentia. And if you search Laurentia, you will find that graphic without the black arrows. And what you'll see clearly is that the graphic matches up with the edge of the plate as seen from aerial photography. So just keep that craton graphic in mind and look where the earthquake is on the southern eastern edge, and it's proof that the edge of the plate is being displaced. Now that's controversial. You know why? Because professionals said it couldn't be. They said force travels from the Mid-Atlantic Ridge across the United States towards the West Coast. No, that's the way the physical plate is moving on the surface. It turns out the seismic force is happening in the opposite direction than which the plates move, which is amazing. Like a conveyor belt, the underside's moving the opposite direction than the top side is. How about that? Now, as we look one more time across the west, new 5.0 earthquake has just been reported here in the past, let's see, at 2:34 UTC an hour ago. Right when I started, guys. All right, right when I started, a new 5.0 earthquake is reported. I want you to be prepared. In Hawaii, I want you to be prepared for new 5.0 earthquakes and possibly even larger as this thing continues to expand. And I want you to find out whether or not your island is shifting. If that means you've got to grill your professionals and tell them you want GPS measurements across the island, don't let them tell you that they don't have them. They have GPS measurements for the island. I don't know what I'm doing with that stuff. I can go learn it. Probably take me a few days, but I could probably go learn it. In that time, a professional can go pull it immediately and begin study and get it out to the world and let everybody know if the island is slightly shifting. If the island is slightly shifting, that sure as heck would explain why you're getting fours going from Hilo all the way up to the other island of the west. I mean, come on, you're spreading out across the whole island with 3.9 and 4.0 activity now. Doesn't that mean the island's slightly shifting? It's okay to admit that. It's not anything to worry about. This is normal for the island when there's drainage happening at the volcanoes. Out in Hawaii, this is a regular occurrence. This is how the island forms and grows. It means new real estate forming here along the island, not less. And it means that the people that live there are fully prepared and capable of handling this and withstanding anything that goes down, even if Mauna Loa were to somehow start to come to life. Look, it erupted in 1983. Everybody's still there, right? And it's not going to erupt. In my opinion, I don't think Mauna Loa is going to go. I think the whole island is slightly moving. That would make more sense. The southeast portion starts to deflate, allowing a little bit of shifting to happen. Then you start seeing some threes and fours strike between the different volcanoes, going all the way across the big island. USGS says, oh, we can't tell anybody, we've got to keep it quiet. And then they issue an asinine statement saying that the volcano is showing no activity at Mauna Loa or anywhere else, and that there's background seismicity around the area. Background seismicity? Oh, facepalm. Look, we can go ahead and downplay something while not deny it, and we need to downplay the fear pornography, as we call it. It's fear addiction. It's an addiction to something that gets you excited, and that's fear. And we don't like that. That's one of the things we're fighting here online. So there's not going to be some big, huge falling of Hawaii. So many people trying to say that there's going to be a tsunami. Prove it. Let's go ahead and see your surface fractures that extend out for miles going out to the sea. Don't show me just some cracks across some road. That's normal fissuring that happens on the surface as a result of the magma moving underneath. I want to see these big 20-foot wide cracks that would go on for 50 miles in all directions around where the thing's going to break off and fall in and cause a huge tsunami, like you guys online are all saying. Here's a spot where that happened before. This spot actually broke off and fell in. You can see where it broke off and fell in a long, long time ago off the North Island. And the name of that, I think, is Hualalai. Let's find out. Or is that the one to the north? That's the one to the south. To the north, Kohala. This is broken off and fallen in the past, a long time ago. How wide is that? How many miles is that? 10 miles wide, 11 miles wide. And it went down 3,000 to 4,000 feet. It fell in over the distance of 10 miles. So 10 miles wide, fell 10 miles out, and fell down 3,000 feet. Now, how long did that take? Was it quick or was it slow? Now, you have to understand the reason that happened here is because it built up. Look at the peaks. Look at how, look at it this way. And look at how far of a cliffside that is. Do you see this? These cliffsides. So at some point in the past, magma came down here, pooled up on the side, and then broke off and fell in. That's what happened. And it slid down at some point in the past. Most likely, that's my take on it. I might be wrong, but it sure looks like it. And if that happened there, then of course we would look for something similar to happen at other lava flows that pool up like that. But it's not pooling up. It's spreading out big time across the coast. And there's no doubt about that. Those lava rivers, man, they spread out across miles. And you guys have seen the video of that. You don't have to take my word for it. I would like to remind everybody last night that this 5.0 earthquake struck in Venezuela right where we issued our warning. And now word has reached me there's been a few injuries. I don't like hearing about injuries that happen in areas where we issue warnings. We issued a specific warning for a 5.0 earthquake to be striking the Eastern Caribbean from the tip of Venezuela into the Leeward Islands right here. That's what the warning was. And that was on Sunday night. And it hit yesterday, Friday, here in the States. So it took all week. It took 5 days for the earthquake to strike. But that was 5 days that the people in Venezuela could have been warned, that somebody could have gotten the video to them somehow. I don't speak Spanish, no habla español, but I've turned on closed captioning below my videos so that people can translate. And if you know someone there, God, there's got to be some dual English-speaking people somewhere that would at least type an email to their friends in Spanish and say, hey, Venezuela, you may want to watch out for a new five on land right here at the tip. We're warning you, and you're going to get hit this week. Because then that way, the people at least know to look for it. Right now, as it stands, I don't think anybody down there got my warning issued on Sunday night. Now, why were we looking there? Anybody remember? We have to go back several days. We had a cluster of earthquakes and eruptions over in Central America, including Fuego, but multiple fours and fives. Multiple fours and a five add up to a 5.1, and that's what we got downstream. right in Venezuela. And it's going to keep on going. It's not going to stop in Venezuela. It's going to keep on going out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And maybe by tomorrow, I have my new forecast coming out tomorrow night. I don't think it matters to anybody out here. There are no islands here. There are no islands here. No islands here. So no one's going to feel the earthquake when it strikes. But it's going to strike out there at the termination point. Then it'll go through the planet and come back out on the opposite side with a new deep earthquake. In case you don't know, hey, everybody, listen to me, seriously, listen. These deep earthquakes push up on the underside of the plate. I've already talked about that 20 times. But the force travels across the plates, path of least resistance style, following the arrows. The arrows are the plate boundaries and the craton edges. And then it reaches the Mid-Atlantic Ridge where we have our X marks. When the force reaches the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, it goes back through the planet and comes out on the antipode, on the opposite side, with a new deep quake that starts the cycle over again. And we can get into a feedback loop where there's enough deep earthquakes that happen, and the force tries to travel out and equalize, but it can't. It gets to here, travels back through the planet, and like a pickup and a beat of a drum, it then goes back through, and comes back around, goes back through, and like a feedback loop, a microphone picking up its own sound, it starts to pick up. It'll pick up in amplitude, and you'll start to pick up in power as this force can't escape in enough time. And all Mother Nature is trying to do here, there's force created down below the plate. It's trying to equalize that force, and the only way it can, since it's coming up from below the plate, is to spread it out across the plate boundaries, which then intersect the other plates, and the other plates go into motion because the deep earthquakes pushing the Pacific plate to begin with. And then mixed in with all that, a hot mess of volcanoes, and I don't even do volcano forecasting. And we could go down the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center list for today. It's kind of pointless at this point, but we've got a number of volcanoes that are erupting. I think there's 8 on one side on the West Pacific and 4 on the other, which means we're lopsided. We have 12 total eruptions going on, though. And that's enough right there. So if we have 12 different volcanoes going and multiple deep earthquakes going, it's a sign of force coming up from underneath the plate. Something's exerting pressure and force. What's exerting the pressure and force? I think we already know. And if you're new here, you didn't know until we just told you. The deep earthquakes. Now there's ultimately what's causing the deep earthquakes, which gets into another video that would take me about an hour or more, which is the discussion about what's below the plates and what's at the core of the Earth. Now, you might be mind blown to find out that I would throw out all the current models and all the current hogwash, as I call it, hypotheses, not even theories, because nobody can prove what the core of the Earth is. I would throw most of those solid core models out and replace it with plasma energy, which is like lightning bolt material almost, electrons that are cascading down to the core of the Earth, but much more powerful. And it reflects like it's a solid. That's the key to plasma. It reflects like a solid. So if you're getting a seismic wave reflected off the core of the Earth, scientists up until now thought that meant, and I don't blame them, they thought it meant that it was solid. Of course, you're getting a reflection off, or the wave is passing through like it's a solid. Well, then you would deduce that it's a solid. But now that we know that electrical plasma energy reflects waves, shock waves, not just radio waves, it actually reflects shock waves. Boeing even patented something using an electrical arc generator, generating a lightning bolt plasma out away from a Humvee, and it reflects incoming shock waves, and it'll protect the vehicle from an incoming blast. It doesn't stop the shrapnel, the physical stuff flying through the air. It stops the shock wave, the blast wave that blows the entire vehicle over. And if human-made electrical arcs will stop man-made blasts, then Mother Nature, with its plasma core, will reflect huge amounts of energy away as if it's a solid. That's my contention. I can't prove it. I can't go down to the core of the Earth, but we could talk about that for a couple hours to get that fully explained to you, to explain how the core of the Earth is not a solid ball of metal, which then justifies and explains how there's an expansion that's happening, a heating that's occurring that melts all the elements, and why there's a convection, a cycle, and why there's oscillation of a magnetic current down at the core of the Earth. That all being said, you guys, I know that sounds a little complex, you need to have an earthquake plan. With deep earthquakes going on like they're going on now, and with volcanoes going, again, I don't forecast volcanoes, but with the volcanoes going, it definitely means we're taking another step up this coming week. We're going back up beyond sixes now. We're coming out of sixes. We're going to take a step up, and that's going to be my forecast for this week. So far, we've had 1-6 and a bunch of fives and a bunch of deep earthquakes. It's leading into something big, and I want you to be ready for it. It's been a while. It's been a few months since we've had any large earthquakes of any kind, anywhere on the entire planet. Any 7s, 8s, 9s, nothing like that. In a long time, I want you to be ready for large earthquake activity. With Krakatoa erupting, with the deep earthquakes going the way we're going, it's a good idea just to dust off those plans. And if you don't have an earthquake plan, you need to develop one. Which means just think about it in your head. What am I going to do if an earthquake strikes? You're going to go take shelter. But where? Where are you going to take shelter? Everybody thinks the door frame, right? No, you're not supposed to go into a door frame. So don't do the door frame thing. It means table or desk. And a table or desk will then protect you from falling debris of a certain weight. But even those table or desks are not going to protect you from a collapsing structure. So you need also to have an exit plan in case your structure starts sounding like it's not going to withstand the power of the earthquake. If you're in a brick or a cinder block house, please, guys, listen to me. If you're in a brick house or a cinder block house and you start to feel an earthquake, you need to immediately start making your way to the door. Don't wait around to find out if it's a large quake. Think about it. You're in a stone structure, most likely on a stone foundation. You're not supposed to be shaking at all. And any shaking that's happening in a stone building will be weakening the mortar, the bonding between the bricks. And the bonding between the bricks will become weakest at the points where the bricks meet up and have weight transferring through them. So think of the corner of the room or the corner of the building. So you'll start to get fractures that go up the corner of the brick wall. And then the whole brick wall stays mortared together, but it falls all at once. Like a fence being blown over in the wind, only in this case, a brick wall falling made of hundreds of bricks weighing thousands of pounds. And that happens on a regular basis in earthquakes above 4.5 going into the 5.0 range and greater. So we start seeing brick collapses within 15, 20, 30 seconds of a 5.0 earthquake. And think about that, 30 seconds. If you're asleep in the middle of the night, you live in one of these kind of houses, it's a choice you're making. Look, I'm not going to lecture you on this kind of stuff, but you know what to do if you live in a brick house now. I'm telling you, you need to have a plan. Finally, get an emergency kit. Put it together yourself. Save yourself a lot of money. Now, you can order that crap online. I get it. You can get a nice bag with all the stuff in it. But you likely have the stuff in your house. So that means flashlight, batteries, extra insurance card, extra ID, extra set of keys, change of clothes, extra set of shoes and socks. Put all that stuff into a bag. And maybe do it for your spouse or your kids if you've got it. And have that bag not too heavy, but lightweight enough that you can grab it at a moment's notice, whether you're running out of the building or whether you're going to shelter in place. You'll also use it for other things. It won't just be for earthquakes. You'll probably use it in a severe weather situation. You'll get your bug out bag. It'll have the batteries in it. Emergency radio. Another good idea. I know those cost money, but it's money well spent. You'll probably never have to use it, but in the case of an emergency, that's the key. And I'm not trying to get all preachy on you. I just want you to survive so you can come back here and watch another YouTube video. Hey, look at the screen. Hold on. Look what's going on in beautiful Hawaii right now. Surely that's not real. Surely the USGS has invested in computer graphics of some kind. Oh, boy. You know, is there a pot of gold down at the end of that rainbow? I don't know. It depends on if I put apocalypse into the title of my video for Hawaii. Apocalyptic rainbow. Hey, how about that for the title of the video? Apocalyptic rainbow appears in Hawaii. That'll get everybody's attention. And then I'll pass through YouTube, no problem. Oh. Yes, rainbow apocalypse. Have you ever seen the rainbow guy? That rainbow video guy? Yes, it's a rainbow. Okay. Oh my God, it's a rainbow. Oh my God, what does it mean? What does it mean? Oh. All right, if you don't know what I'm talking about, you gotta go look up rainbow guy. You'll get it then. And until tomorrow, I'll be back on tomorrow morning. Guys, be safe. Much love. Peace out. One other thing, how many people are in here? Let's go find out. Let's go over and say hi to everybody in chat. Let's see. 1,300 people still in here. Awesome. Here, let's turn on live chat so we can see everybody. Let's just name out some names. I don't know most of you. A lot of people in here I've never seen before. Makina, Scott Martin, Shell Nicole, Amanda, John. Hey, welcome back. Timothy, Ella, Nicole. Spoonman, hey, you're a regular. We call you the regular guy. Okay, Cherry Case, Ricky Rick, everybody. Tip Top 22, word up to all of you. I want to show you something. If you're paying attention, look at the screen. dutchsinse is now official. YouTube has offered me my own Teespring account, which is like t-shirts and that kind of stuff. So if you want to get your official dutchsinse merchandise, you can go over to the Teespring link down below the video. And it does help me. It helps my operation. They cut me in on 50% of this. So that's awesome. And if you guys get a t-shirt, you can spread the word on earthquake awareness. And other than that, I don't have much else for you. I want to thank everybody who is spreading the word. And this is the first I've ever really had anything like this official from anything. All the other stuff, I had to create my own shirts. You know, one of these t-shirt stores where you set it up. All right. Well, this one is offered through YouTube, and you'll see the links down below the video. Hopefully, you'll see it down below the video, and it'll say recommended merchandise for dutchsinse. So that is official. That is from me. I did, you know, this little thing myself. You guys, this is a big deal for me. Becoming like Philip DeFranco. Oh boy, we're going to sign off now. Have a good morning, afternoon, evening, or night. Truman Show style, of course. Drink your Mococo. Peace out. Yes, the link is down below. I saw somebody in chat just saying, where's the link? It is down below in the description of the live stream. Or when I save it as a video, it'll be in the description of the video as well. So there's a link. It's like one of the top links right below the Global Earthquake Forecasting Confirmed link. There is another one to the Teespring official dutchsinse store stuff. All right. Peace out.